That concludes topical questions. The next item of business is a statement by Nicola Sturgeon on COVID-19 update. The First Minister will take questions at the end of her statement, and so there should be no interventions or interruptions. And I call on Nicola Sturgeon, First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Today I'll set out the latest assessment of the COVID data and its impacts, and I will give brief updates on some key issues, the ongoing consideration of guidance for schools and early year settings, surveillance of the BA2 subtype of Omicron, and the progress and current focus of vaccination efforts. I'll conclude then with a reminder that there are still some basic steps we can and should continue to take, even in an improving situation, to curb transmission and thereby reduce pressure on the NHS economy and wider society. I'll start though with a brief account of today's statistics. 6,630 positive cases were reported yesterday through PCR and lateral flow tests. 950 people are in hospital with COVID, which is 8 fewer than yesterday. 31 people are in intensive care, 5 fewer than yesterday. That includes 13 patients who've been in ICU for more than 28 days, and sadly a further 14 deaths have been reported, which takes the total number of deaths under the daily definition to 10,447. And once again, my condolences go to everyone mourning a loved one. Over the past fortnight, case numbers have remained broadly stable. Last week I reported that cases had risen slightly by around 2% in the preceding 7 days. By contrast, over the past week, the most recent week, reported case numbers have declined again from an average of 7,400 a day to just over 7,000 a day, which is a fall of 5%. While that continues a positive overall trend, it's important to note that it does mask some significant variations between different age groups. Amongst the under-15s, which, remember, is the age cohort in which cases have been rising in recent weeks, even as they declined overall. But in the most recent week, there was a fall of more than a quarter amongst the under-15s. Cases also fell by 6% in the 25 to 44-year-old age group and by more than 10% in those aged 75 and over. However, in other age groups, recorded cases have increased over the past week, and the biggest increase of more than 50% was seen in the 15 to 24-year-old cohort. As I have noted in recent weeks, it was always likely that we'd see some uptick in recorded cases as a result of the return to work in school after Christmas, and more recently, the lifting of protective measures that had played a part in stemming transmission. So we shouldn't be overly surprised by the increase in some age groups, nor at this stage should we be unduly concerned. However, we will continue to monitor these trends and any associated impacts from them. In addition to the daily data, we also continue to pay close attention to the findings of the ONS weekly survey. While it is not as up-to-date as the daily data, it does offer reliable information. The most recent report suggests that in the week to the 29th of January, around 1 in 30 people in Scotland had COVID. While this is an improvement on the earlier part of January and the lowest level of infection of all 4 UK nations, it also represents something of a plateau compared to the week before and is broadly in line with what the more recent daily data has been indicating. The decline and the subsequent plateauing in recorded cases in recent weeks is now being reflected in a slight easing of the direct COVID pressure on our hospitals. In the week to 27th January, 682 patients with COVID were admitted to hospital. In the following week, that fell to 550. Hospital occupancy, the number in hospital with COVID at any given time, has also fallen. Around mid-January, more than 1,500 people were in hospital with COVID. This time last week, that had fallen to just under 1,200, and today it is back below 1,000 at 950. The number of people with COVID in intensive care has also reduced from a recent peak of 70 in January to 42 last Tuesday and 31 today. Indeed, the number in intensive care is now at its lowest level since early July of last year. And we are also now, thankfully, starting to see a decline in the number of deaths of people with COVID. So these are all positive trends that we hope to see continue in the weeks ahead. Finally, on data, I just want to take the opportunity now to flag an imminent change to the rhythm of our reporting. This coming weekend will be the last, at least for now, that we report data for new cases, vaccinations and hospitalisations on Saturdays and Sundays. In future, figures for Saturday and Sunday will be published on Mondays. This reflects the move, we hope, into a calmer phase of the pandemic and so less of an urgent requirement for immediate data over weekends. However, we will be able to move back to weekend reporting should that become necessary at any stage in the future. The situation now remains much more positive than it was at the turn of the year. I think that is evident from all of the data. And that, of course, is thanks to a combination of vaccinations, targeted protective measures and the responsible reaction of the public. And, of course, the situation is much more positive now than we feared it might be at this stage. It seems reasonable, therefore, based on the data, to conclude that we are now through the worst of this wave of Omicron. That has enabled the removal of virtually all of the additional measures that were introduced in December and a return to normality in much of our everyday lives. In particular, the updated guidance on home working has supported a partial return to the office in recent days, with hybrid working where appropriate. These changes have all, I'm sure, been very positive for individuals and for businesses, and they mean that we are on a good track at this stage. To stay on this track, though, continued care and caution remains necessary and prudent. While much more stable than it was, the virus is still widespread. 1 in 30 remains, at this stage, a high level of infection. And although the number needing hospital care is reducing, it is still in the hundreds each week, and pressure on the NHS remains significant. So continuing to take some basic precautions will help us keep the virus under control while, of course, enjoying the return to normal life. That is why some baseline protective measures, such as COVID certification and the requirement to wear face coverings in certain settings, will remain in force for now. And it is also why we continue to recommend that we all take lateral flow tests before mixing with people from other households. As well as reducing our own individual risk of getting COVID and therefore helping to stem transmission overall, these basic measures will also provide some reassurance for those who are at the highest risk of serious illness if they get COVID. It's important, and I'm sure we'll all agree with this point, it's important that everyone gets to benefit from a return to greater normality. So collective behaviours that could force those at highest risk into effective isolation while the rest of us get back to enjoying normal life would not be acceptable. People in the higher risk category already carry a lot of responsibility for protecting their own health and rely on the advice of GPs and other clinicians to reduce risks of infection. As we enter the next phase of the pandemic, regular communication from the Scottish Government and the Chief Medical Officer will seek to support this. However, we all have a part to play in making the environments in which we work and socialise as safe as possible for everyone, and complying with basic protective measures helps to do this. Employers, of course, have a particular responsibility to consider the needs of people on the high-risk list in their plans for hybrid working. We've added some specific workplace guidance for people at highest risk on mygov.scot, so anyone on the high-risk list who is worried about a return to the workplace is encouraged to check that advice and discuss it with their employer. Finally, I'm pleased to say there's been already good take-up of the Distance Aware scheme that was launched 2 weeks ago. This scheme provides badges and lanyards that can be worn by anyone who wants or needs additional space and consideration when they are out and about in public places. These are available at Asda stores and in libraries for anyone who would feel safer with a bit more space around them. And of course, if you see someone wearing one of these distance aware badges or lanyards, please respect that and give them the space and consideration that they are asking for. There are three further issues, Presiding Officer, that I want to briefly cover today. Firstly, and as I indicated last week, the Advisory Subgroup on Education is meeting this afternoon. It will consider again, based on the up-to-date data, whether secondary school children should continue to wear face coverings in the classroom. The Scottish Government will consider carefully any further advice that the subgroup provides and confirm any decisions as quickly as possible and in advance of the return to school after the February break. Secondly, we continue to monitor the BA2 subtype of Omicron. Last week, I indicated that there were 26 cases of this subtype confirmed in Scotland through genomic sequencing. I can report today that the number of confirmed cases has now risen to 103. Not all tests are or can be genomically sequenced, so we know that this will be a significant underestimate of actual prevalence. And indeed, in the past week, there has been a further increase in the number of PCR test results showing positive for the S gene and a corresponding fall in the number which don't have the S gene. This is likely to reflect an increase in BA2 cases, which, like Delta, are S gene positive. Of course, in cases of the main Omicron variant, the S gene is absent. Encouragingly, there remains no evidence at this stage that the disease caused by this subtype is any more severe than that caused by the main Omicron variant, nor does it appear to be any more capable of evading the immunity conferred by either vaccination or prior infection. However, there is evidence from more than one country now of a growth advantage for BA2 compared to the main Omicron variant, which may mean that it is more transmissible. All in all, however, there are no grounds at this stage for any significant concern about this subtype and no reason to change our approach in response to it. We will, though, continue to monitor it carefully. The final issue I want to address today is vaccination. We are continuing to offer and encourage vaccination for any 5 to 11-year-old who has an underlying health condition, putting them at higher risk should they get COVID, and also for any 5 to 11-year-old who is a household contact of someone who is immune suppressed. All parents and carers of children in these categories have been contacted about vaccination. I would strongly encourage anyone who has been contacted and whose child has not yet been vaccinated to book an appointment. Case rates in younger age groups, while now falling, as I indicated earlier, are still relatively high. So vaccination is an important way of providing better protection for children who might be at higher risk. A new marketing campaign is also being launched today to stress again the importance of vaccination, including booster vaccines. Invitations to scheduled appointments have been going out to all 18 to 59-year-olds who are eligible for a booster but haven't yet received it. If you are one of these people, please do go along to your scheduled appointment or rearrange it for a more convenient time. And you can do that through the NHS Inform website or by phoning the vaccination hotline. It is beyond any doubt that getting the booster significantly reduces your chance of falling seriously ill from COVID. It's not an exaggeration to say that it could be the difference between life and death for someone who contracts the virus. So please do go and get your booster if you're eligible. It is the most important thing any of us can do to protect ourselves from COVID and also to help protect the NHS. Presiding Officer, the ongoing use of vaccination in our efforts against COVID will be a key part of an updated strategic framework, which will set out in greater detail our approach to managing COVID more sustainably and less restrictively in the remaining phases of the pandemic and then as the virus hopefully becomes endemic. We continue to engage with a range of interests on the contents of this updated framework. However, I can confirm today that we intend to publish it on the 22nd of February, immediately following the February recess. Parliament will subsequently get an opportunity to debate and vote on it. For the moment, however, I want to end today by reflecting again our increased optimism about the period ahead. However, after almost 2 years of this ordeal, I know getting back to normal for short periods followed by further disruption to our lives is not what any of us want. A return to normal that is sustained is what we want and are striving for, and that is what the updated strategic framework will be aiming to support. However, we can all help keep things on a more even keel now by taking all of the reasonably straightforward precautions that we continue to advise. So firstly, a reminder to please get fully vaccinated as soon as you can if you haven't already done so. Second, continue to take some care when socialising and in particular take a lateral flow test before meeting other people socially. And finally, please take the other precautions that we know are making a difference. Talk to your employer about a return to hybrid working and follow the guidance and precautions they adopt to make workplaces safer. Wear face coverings on public transport and shops, and when moving about in hospitality, keep windows open if possible when meeting indoors, and follow all of the advice on hygiene. All of these measures will help us to protect each other while we return to more normal lives and keep all of us, I hope, on the right track. So please stick with them. Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm happy now, of course, to move to questions.
Thank you. The First Minister will now take questions on the issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 30 minutes for questions, after which we'll move on to the next item of business. I'd be grateful if members wish to ask a question. Please press the request to speak button now or place an R in the chat function. And I call Sandesh Gulhani.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me start by urging everyone who can to come forward to get their COVID vaccine booster. It's the single most important thing that you can do to tackle COVID. Turning to the First Minister's statement, for the second week in a row, this COVID update has contained very little new information. The biggest update is that the government will finally publish its new strategic framework. But not until after the February break, more than 6 weeks after it was promised. Today, we have published our own blueprint for starting to move beyond COVID. Our policy paper, Back to Normality, contains a series of recommendations for protecting public services and accelerating Scotland's recovery from the pandemic. We believe it's time to move on from blanket legal restrictions to an approach that emphasises personal responsibility. We must get Scotland back as close to normal for as many people as possible. So, can I ask the First Minister, the mandate for face masks in classrooms is continuing to hamper young people's education. Pupils are wearing their masks for 7 hours a day, while adults can sit in a pub freely without a face covering. Does the First Minister not appreciate what the government is putting kids through by keeping this rule in place? Another crucial part of our policy paper, and an issue of personal concern to me, is more support for the tens of thousands of Scots affected by the debilitating condition of long COVID. It is 5 months since the Scottish Government published its long COVID strategy, but we still do not have a network of long COVID clinics for patients to access. So can the First Minister tell me when patients will be able to access this service? Finally, let me ask, the test and protect system was incredibly useful in the early stages of the pandemic. It is far less effective since Omicron emerged. Meanwhile, frontline NHS services are in desperate need of more resources. Waiting times are growing longer all the time and fewer operations are going ahead. So will the First Minister consider moving resources from Test and Protect to frontline health services in Scotland's NHS?
First Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In relation to the various points raised, firstly, I think, certainly I believe from the feedback I get on the back of statements like this, people out there really do want to know what the latest trends in infection are and the advice that they are being given to try to keep themselves safe and protected. And we'll continue to communicate regularly and as clearly as possible with the public across the country. Of course, in the last few weeks, we have been lifting and have now lifted virtually all of the measures that were introduced in December in the face of the Omicron variant. And we'll continue to take responsible steps to return the country to normal as far as possible. On the issue of face masks, as I said, the advisory subgroup is meeting this afternoon. I think it's really important, particularly when we are discussing the safety of children, that we do take expert advice, and that is what we will do. Up until now, the expert advice has been to continue with the position on face coverings, given the risk, and given until this week the rising level of infections amongst young people of school age. And there is a difference, and I think most people understand the difference between adults in pubs and children in schools. The former, of course, is voluntary, the latter is not. And adults have higher vaccination levels than young people because we started vaccinating young people later than adults. So that is why it is right, I think, and has been right to take a different approach there. In terms of long COVID, we are already taking action to ensure that people are supported in the most appropriate way possible. The £10 million long COVID support fund is targeted at the areas where additional resource is needed. We continue to implement the 16 different commitments in that plan. Long COVID clinics are one model that boards will consider, but there is no one single approach that is likely to fit all areas and circumstances, which is why we support a range of approaches and will continue to do so. Finally, Presiding Officer, in relation to the strategic framework, I think it's right and proper, particularly as we have now lifted most of the measures that were in place, that we think very carefully about the medium to long-term approach that we take. This is a time, I think, where we need to think quite fundamentally about the approaches that are right for the future, but it is also important that we think carefully about this. There is a temptation, and I understand it, to say that because COVID is now more under control, that we should lift all of the basic protections. But in actual fact, it is some of those basic protections that has helped us get it under control and will help us keep it under control. And that is true of test and protect. Of course, there are decisions to be taken about it for the longer term. But right now, contact tracing and the universal testing offer is a key way in which we're helping to keep infection under control and, crucially, to help give additional assurance to those that are most vulnerable. If I'm contacted by Test and Protect to be told that I've been a close contact of a positive case, then that will help me behave in a way that breaks transmission chains generally, but it will also mean I can behave in a way that doesn't put those that are most vulnerable at highest risk. So these are important interventions right now, and we'll consider their future very carefully. And of course, we'll look carefully at the proposals published by the Conservatives, as we will at those published by Labour, but we'll take responsible and proportionate actions to support the country through this and back to normal in a safe and sustainable way.
Anna Sarwar.
Can I start by sending my condolences to all those that have lost a loved one? Presiding Officer, nowhere has there been greater failings during this pandemic than in our care homes. But yet again, no mention of care homes in the First Minister's statement. From the transfer of positive and untested patients to the lack of PPE, the government allowed care homes to become the epicentre of the pandemic with tragic consequences. A third of all deaths in this pandemic have been in our care homes. Then for months, despite restrictions starting to ease, care homes remained locked down. We know the harm and trauma caused by keeping care home residents cruelly cut off from their loved ones. But even now, families are being locked out. Residents testing positive are still required to isolate for 10 days, and homes with outbreaks must close for 14 days, with only named visitors allowed. Heartbroken relatives have said this leads to rolling lockdowns, which can last for weeks. The campaign group Care Home Relatives Scotland have been pleading repeatedly with the First Minister, and I've been reading almost on a daily basis the heartbreaking personal stories that they have been sharing. They've been pleading with the First Minister to make it easier for them to see their loved ones. The government promised to implement Anne's Law, the proposals, and give family caregivers a statutory right of access to care homes. But 3 months on from the consultation closing, relatives still say there is too little sign of progress. So what will the First Minister do to guarantee access for families right now? And when will her government finally deliver Anne's Law so residents are never cut off from their loved ones again?
First Minister.
Firstly, there are few people that have borne a bigger impact from this virus than those in care homes and the relatives of those in care homes. I think for anybody who hasn't been in the position of having a loved one in a care home during the past 2 years, it's very difficult to understand, I think, just how anxious and distressing a time it has been. So I want to recognise that very readily. At all stages, and obviously the situation in care homes at all stages of the pandemic will be one of the key areas of focus for the public inquiry that will shortly get underway, and that is right and proper. I can say, as the person who has led the government's response since the outset of this pandemic, we have sought to take the best decisions based on the best evidence we had at any given time to keep those in our care homes as safe as possible. It has often been a feature of the political scrutiny on the government that at an earlier stage the criticism was that we didn't act rigorously enough to protect those in care homes. At later stages, it has sounded sometimes as if the criticism has been that we are acting too protectively and too rigorously. Inevitably, there will be balances that we have had to strike along the way to try to get that right. We want to get the situation in care homes back to complete normality as much as possible. In recent weeks, of course, there have been changes made to isolation periods, to the testing requirements, bringing the situation more in line with the general population. And we will continue to support change in order that people can visit normally their loved ones in care homes. And Anne's Law, we have given a commitment to introduce that, but it's proper that we do that carefully, consider all the responses to the consultation and set out the way forward on that fully in due course, but as soon as possible.
Alex Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. It's clear from this afternoon's statement that we may be looking forward to a life beyond face masks in our schools. And on the one hand, that is very welcome, both for well-being and cohesion in our classrooms. However, teaching unions have expressed still some anxieties, not least because we learned last week of the significant problems of air quality in our classroom. We also learned this week that in Edinburgh schools alone, infection rates have quadrupled since Christmas. Schools are very much still on the front line of this pandemic. Now, the teaching profession and health and safety bodies have said that the best way to remove CO2 and infections from our school is in the installation of HEPA air filters into every classroom in Scotland. So instead of her government's baffling adventures in woodwork, does the First Minister recognise the importance of installing these air cleaning devices in each of our classrooms, both to drive down infection and to improve attainment?
First Minister.
Yes, I do consider that where the judgment and the assessment of those who are qualified to make these assessments is that HEPA filters or other air filtration systems are required, then those should be installed. Indeed, that is why we have provided funding to local authorities to facilitate that and enable that to happen. It is not the case that that will be required in every learning space, and indeed in some learning spaces mechanical ventilation systems are also important. But we have enabled through the additional funding local authorities to take the decisions that they consider appropriate, taking of course all health and safety advice along the way, and I think that is the right and proper way to support schools to be as safe as possible. It is the case that there are a range of measures that have been necessary and may continue to be necessary in the future, face coverings being one of those. We don't want any of these measures to be in place for as long as possible, but the safety of young people, certainly from the perspective of the government, is the overriding priority as we make these decisions.
Emma Harper, to be followed by Douglas Lumsden.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. First Minister, businesses are now able to allow staff to return to workplaces, such as offices, either full-time or with a hybrid approach. This can be hugely beneficial to health and wellbeing, but some have concerns about returning to a face-to-face work environment, and businesses have contacted me about the cost of having offices COVID risk assessed and any associated changes. Can the First Minister outline what guidance the Scottish Government is offering businesses to ensure workplaces are COVID safe?
First Minister.
Well, it is, I think, a positive that a return to offices and other workplaces is more possible now, and I think hybrid working has a lot to commend it. But it is important that workplaces are safe environments. And there are many people, while the majority of us are very keen to get back to normality, there are some people, particularly those in the high-risk groups, who are anxious about that and who are nervous about the risk that that might pose to them. I think that is particularly true in the workplace. So, as I said in my statement, it is incumbent on employers to make sure they follow all of the guidance and take appropriate steps to make their workplaces as safe as possible. As I also indicated, Safer Workplaces guidance has been published online at gov.scot to help employers make their workplaces safer. That's updated regularly in consultation with stakeholders. And of course, it enables employees to get advice as well that they can then discuss with their employers. So this is a crucial period, I think, of building the confidence of people to get back to work as well as back to normality in other ways, and employers have a particular responsibility to help us do that.
Douglas Lumsden, to be followed by Evelyn Tweed.
Presiding Officer, I received a follow-on message from a constituent with a child in fifth year at school. The impact of face masks on hearing impaired pupils has been catastrophic and disproportionately affects them. Face masks not only take away their vital method of communication, lip reading and facial expression, it also reduces sound and distorts normal speech, which as hearing people we all take for granted. The whole impact of wearing face masks in schools for those pupils will not be felt for years to come, when the life chances of hearing impaired pupils will be less than their hearing peers, and yet again they fall further behind and disadvantaged. Every single day this policy in place, it takes away future hopes, dreams and friendships of hearing impaired pupils. First Minister, what is your message to this parent?
First Minister.
I understand the views of that parent. I could come here any week and I could read out messages that I receive that are of similar sentiments to the one that has just been read out. Equally, I could read out lots of messages I receive from the other perspective, from parents and from pupils and from teachers, saying please don't remove the requirement for face coverings prematurely, because we believe that will put us at greater risk. The point I'm making is that there are understandably and hardly surprisingly different opinions here. And those opinions, I think, are particularly sincerely expressed when it is around children with hearing impairments or other learning disabilities. Of course, there have always been exemptions from the wearing of face coverings, and generally there is a need to support children whose education has been disrupted because of the experience of the past 2 years. But it is important that we don't take some sort of politically ideological approach to this. It is the case that we need to take careful decisions, to listen to parents, to listen to teachers, to listen to young people themselves, but to come to balanced views that recognise the risks and the dangers of this virus, and to recognise our responsibility to try to navigate a way through it that keeps young people in particular as safe as possible. And these are serious responsibilities that the government will continue to take extremely seriously.
Evelyn Tweed, to be followed by Jackie Bailey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The launch of the Distance Aware campaign will have been welcome for those who have been at higher risk of COVID or feel very anxious about going out in public. Can the First Minister outline what steps are being taken to publicise the campaign and to encourage shops and other venues to share the messaging so that consumers have the confidence to return to going about their daily lives?
First Minister.
Well, we're working with a range of organisations and businesses to promote the initiative amongst their staff and customers. There's a bespoke awareness-raising online toolkit, and posters have also been sent to stakeholders across Scotland. As I indicated in my opening remarks, early uptake has been good, which I think suggests that there are many people who do want just that added bit of reassurance to give them the confidence to get back to normal, whether that's in workplaces, shopping or socialising. And if that helps, I think that's a good thing, and we should all try to respect that where we see people wearing these badges or lanyards. It's totally voluntary. People are not required to do it. And of course, anybody can request these materials if they think it would help. We are in a transition back to normality. I hope it will be sustained and sustainable normality. But some people are more nervous about that than others. And some people, of course, remain at higher risk of COVID than others. So if we all pull together, as we have done through the earlier stages of the pandemic, and support each other in this way, then I think it makes that transition all the easier, but it is likely to make it more sustainable as well.
Jackie Bailey, to be followed by Bob Dorris.
Presiding Officer, the Daily Record reported that 4 children aged between 5 and 11 and clinically vulnerable were given COVID vaccine overdoses, more than twice the approved amount in NHS Lanarkshire. They received adult doses rather than those designed for children. At least one of the children was very seriously ill for a whole week as a result. I've also since been contacted by a mother whose 11-year-old daughter was given the wrong vaccine dosage, this time in NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. Her daughter was desperately unwell for 2 weeks, but months later the symptoms returned and she ended up in hospital. Given the unfortunate side effects experienced by these children, and to ensure confidence in the vaccination programme, which is so important, will the First Minister order an urgent review of the administration of vaccinations to children and at least ensure that the different doses for children and adults are colour-coded to avoid future error?
First Minister.
Well, of course, in the face of any incident like this, we will take any steps that we consider to be appropriate. This was a small number of children who were incorrectly administered with a higher than recommended dose of the Pfizer vaccine instead of the paediatric formula. NHS Lanarkshire has apologised for this error and has undertaken the appropriate monitoring that should always be carried out when someone is given more than the recommended dose of a vaccine. We have already been assured that the error was quickly identified, reported, and actions were put in place to ensure that affected parents were fully informed of what had happened. And there is guidance from the UK Health Security Agency about the steps that should be taken. They should be reassured in this case that it is not harmful, but we nevertheless will ensure that there is proper review of this and any appropriate steps taken as a result.
Bob Dorris, to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Presiding Officer, can I draw Parliament's attention to the fact that a number of education authorities in England are advising that masks remain in place, at least in school communal areas for the time being, despite the change in England's national guidance? First Minister, this is because of a significant rise in new COVID outbreaks in English schools. Does the First Minister think that the Scottish Tories' impatience to remove protections in Scotland and follow the lead of Boris Johnson, for reasons that I simply cannot comprehend, risks putting the safety of our young children and teachers at risk?
First Minister.
I'll leave other political parties to explain their own positions. I know the Scottish Conservatives have tended to oppose every reasonable measure that we have advocated to help control this virus, and it is for them to explain that. But we will continue to take the steps and take the decisions that we consider to be appropriate and responsible. And that is the case generally, but I think it is particularly important that we do that when children are concerned. Nobody wants face coverings to be a requirement in schools for longer than necessary, but until this week we have seen rising numbers of cases in the younger age groups of school-aged children, and infection levels, although thankfully they are now falling, remain relatively high, and we see outbreaks in schools which of course are disruptive to education. So we've got to get the balance right here and take expert advice as we do it, and that's why the meeting and the deliberations of the advisory subgroup this afternoon are so important in reaching the right decisions on all of this.
Gillian Mackay, to be followed by Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm aware of instances where children between the ages of 5 and 11 are unable to receive a COVID vaccine despite being in regular close contact with an immunosuppressed person because they are not classed as a household contact. I'm sure the First Minister will appreciate that childcare arrangements often mean that children are in prolonged contact with family members such as grandparents, although they may not live with them. What flexibility is there to allow children who are close but not household contacts of immunosuppressed people to be given the vaccine?
First Minister.
Well, I think there should be an appropriately flexible approach taken to that. I will undertake to discuss the particular point with clinical advisers and write to Gillian Mackay and make the answer to this more widely available as well. The position we take here should reflect the lived reality of children who may, through their own health conditions, be more vulnerable, or through contact with people who have compromised immune systems, be vulnerable in that sense, rather than any definitions that are overly rigid. That said, the advice on these matters does come from the JCVI, and it's important that we honour and respect that advice as well. But I'll discuss the particular point with clinical advisers and revert to Gillian Mackay as soon as possible.
Christine Graham, to be followed by Tess White.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I very much welcome progress in overcoming COVID, but now I think it's important the public, particularly those over 65, are reminded of the importance of the flu vaccine. Can I therefore ask, if you're over 65 and did not receive your flu vaccine along with a COVID vaccination, how do you now access that vaccination for flu?
First Minister.
Well, we did take the decision, and indeed I reported this decision to Parliament, to pause flu vaccinations to allow the immediate challenge of delivering booster vaccinations for COVID to be prioritised. Local health boards, though, are now offering flu vaccinations again to the following high-risk groups who hadn't already received it, although uptake was high when we took the decision to pause it. So those who can now access flu vaccination again are people aged over 65, people with an eligible health condition, pregnant women, frontline health and social care workers, adult unpaid carers and household contacts over 16 years of someone who is severely immunosuppressed. The flu season runs until the end of March, so it's essential that people get vaccinated and get the protection they need, and there is still time to do so. And further information on how to go about arranging a flu vaccination is available through NHS Inform.
I call Tess White, to be followed by Marie McNair.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Bill makes permanent powers to close schools and businesses, enforce lockdowns and release prisoners early. While we must account for the possibility of future variants, we cannot accept legally enforced restrictions as the new normal. Why does the First Minister not scrap this Orwellian piece of legislation?
First Minister.
Utterly ridiculous, and I think we'll be treated as ridiculous by people to describe anything in that way. The bill, because it is a bill, it's not an emergency bill, it's a bill that will go through the full processes of scrutiny by this Parliament. I think in some respects the Conservatives are at risk of misrepresenting some of the contents of that bill, but every single provision in it will be subject to full and proper scrutiny and decision through votes of this Parliament. And the challenge is to get the right balance between the powers and the levers that any government needs to respond quickly to public health emergencies and to not having any emergency powers on the statute book for longer than necessary. And I'm sure everybody across this parliament will rise to the challenge of getting that balance right.
Marie McNair to be followed by Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Symptoms associated with long COVID can have a significant impact on quality of life. Can the First Minister comment on the emerging impact and give an update on the care and support available to people with long COVID in Scotland?
First Minister.
I covered some of this in response to an earlier question. Long COVID does have an impact on both physical and mental well-being, so it's important that we take a range of actions to give people the right support. As I said earlier on, we have already launched the Long COVID Support Fund. That's £10 million of funding, which supports the implementation of the 16 different commitments contained in our approach paper. We've also launched a Long COVID information platform on NHS Inform that can help people manage symptoms, but also signpost people to the information and advice that is available. NHS National Services Division is also establishing a strategic network, which is bringing together clinical experts, NHS boards and people with lived experience to support the ongoing development, resourcing and implementation of services for people who have long COVID.
Paul Sweeney to be followed by John Mason.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. 29-year-old Callum Bulizeg is an inpatient at Gartnavel Royal Hospital. Visits from family are crucial to Callum's care. However, despite changes to self-isolation periods for the general population from the 6th of January, Callum has been required to isolate for a full 10 days, and he's been required to do this no less than 7 times in the last year. Each occasion, Callum's progress is destroyed. He experiences a kind of cognitive setback which was previously observed in care homes and has been rightly condemned as scandalous abuse of human rights. His family are desperate to help him, and whilst the review announced by the Health Secretary earlier today is welcome, does the First Minister agree that the self-evidently excessive and even cruel practice must be ended in mental health wards, and that long-term patients have a fundamental right to social and physical contact with their families?
First Minister.
Yes, I do agree with that, but I also recognise, as I'm sure Paul Sweeney does, that there are some difficult decisions and difficult balances that healthcare professionals have to strike to keep people safe from the risks that the virus has posed. And I hope Paul Sweeney would accept, I'm sure he would accept, that nobody is being cruel or seeking to be cruel in these decisions. They are difficult decisions that have a difficult impact on patients and their families. But I absolutely agree that the human rights and the well-being of patients, particularly long-term patients in our hospitals, is absolutely paramount. I'm happy to ask the Health Secretary to look into the particular constituency case that has been raised by Paul Sweeney and come back to him with any further reflections, having had the opportunity to do so.
John Mason to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you. There have been suggestions that at some point we might need a fourth jag or a second booster, either before the summer or maybe perhaps before next winter. I just wonder if the First Minister could update us in thinking about that.
First Minister.
I think that is certainly something that cannot or should not be ruled out. It may even be probable that there will be further doses of the vaccine required. And of course, the COVID vaccination becomes a regular vaccination programme, just like the flu vaccine already is. But of course, it is for the JCVI to consider the emerging evidence about the virus and, on the strength of that, advise the four governments across the UK how we can continue to use vaccination to prevent severe illness and hospitalisation. So we will continue to be guided by the JCVI. We stand ready to consider any further recommendations it makes and to set out to Parliament how we will intend to implement them as and when they come.
Jeremy Balfour to be followed by Stephanie Callaghan.
Presiding Officer, almost 2 years into the pandemic, day care centres for people with disabilities have still not been opened. These centres used to be a lifeline both for people with disabilities and their carers. A lot of charity one-day services have been open for almost a year with proper protocols in place. So would the First Minister agree with me that these centres should open immediately, and will she have discussions with her council colleagues to make sure that this happens sooner rather than later?
First Minister.
I want to see centres get back to normal, as I want to see the economy and society generally get back to normal. So there is no reason, subject to all of the ongoing precautions, that local authorities cannot open centres such as these, and I would certainly encourage them to look carefully at doing so. There have been previous phases where 2 metre physical distancing made that practically difficult. That has reduced now, and some of the wider precautions are also no longer in place. I would encourage local authorities to get these services back to normal as quickly as possible for people who rely on them.
And Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As the First Minister recognised in today's statement, this is a particularly anxious time for people who were previously shielding, and I welcome the Scottish Government focus on encouraging workplaces to adopt hybrid forms of working. Does the First Minister agree that it is now essential employers engage constructively with employees and trade unions to introduce a safe and effective mix of flexible and hybrid working, particularly where people feel more vulnerable?
First Minister.
Yes, I do agree with that, and I've already addressed some comments to that effect today. I think many employers already are and will be engaging closely with workers, workers' organisations and trade unions in particular, and I would encourage all employers to do that. There is obviously some particular issues that need to be taken into consideration for workers who are in the higher risk groups, and it's important that any plans for hybrid working properly reflect that. As I said earlier on, there is guidance available on the Scottish Government website to assist both employers and workers to reach the right decisions there that allow people to get back to work, which I think most people want to do to a greater or lesser extent, but to do that safely and to have their particular needs properly catered for.
Thank you. That concludes the First Minister's statement, COVID-19 updates. There will be a brief pause as people move seats. And I'll just take this opportunity to remind members that face coverings, that COVID-related measures are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the chamber and across the campus.